So, Spencer, someone told me that you were very interested in talking about Professor Tolkien's writing style.
So interested. Caleb, why don't you tell me about it?
Oh, well, you know what? I sure will, since this isn't the third time we tried to record this. There's no cat attacks right now. I finally started one of those, I forget who wrote those, but those books I got that are, talk about Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
There's a whole bunch of them. The one I started reading was The Hobbit. And I was just perusing through it.
Did you actually finish? Are you done with the trilogy now?
No, I just started the final book yesterday, actually. But before I did that, I just wanted to read a little bit about Hobbits, you know. And I found Tolkien's writing style is very unique in that this whole world he created, all these things and creatures and stuff, it started with the word Hobbit. He starts with the word because he loves words so much. Mm. So he was just like Hobbit, and it had the meaning of Hobbit, which is something to do with a hole digger, somebody digging in holes or burrowing in holes. And then he thought to himself, oh, well, you know, that's an interesting name, Hobbit, and it came from there was a whole chapter just based on the root word of Hobbit. And then he broke down because it was originally spelled different, but what that means, and then what would a creature look like that was like that, mm-hmm. and then, you know, it was just so detailed, all the stuff that Tolkien went into just from the word Hobbit. And I was just you really created a whole universe out of just certain words.
You think he was one of those who was we were talking about the ward builders, you know?
Yeah.
And then, so do you think he just created this, you know, Middle Earth and came up with all this stuff and then came up with a story that, you know, just like that
fit into that world, yeah.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Do you think that's how he did it? Do you know, was he a pantser or was he an outliner or do you...
That I don't know. I would assume he was an outliner.
You'd almost have to think with the detail and all the, you know, all the different categories.
Well, again, it all was really just the languages and the root words of everything that he cared about. And then he created everything off of that. So all the story and stuff, that just came from that. So say whatever elf meant or something, he would go into that and be like, okay, well, if it means this, then what kind of people would arise from that? And then he'd build the world up from these words.
And you know what makes that interesting is he's doing that over 100 years ago,
mm-hmm.
where from what language was then to now,
yeah.
is so interesting to see if somebody tried to do something like that again, or just if you, you know what I mean? Just the, well, just even him, just him doing that, he probably changed a lot of the definitions and defining things of those words now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He's had a big...
Well, you think of Hobbit, you think of Hobbits from Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
You don't think of what they meant before. And it was really interesting, too, because the way he went about this, it wasn't just a Hobbit's this, and then you create a world off it. Bilbo Baggins. Bilbo means certain thing. Baggins means certain things. And then you put them together, and that means it broke down the whole character just from the definitions of the root words. That's what I thought. Hobbits, how they love tea and snacking and doing all this stuff. It was just really interesting how he would put that together to create a character. Words created the characters, not, you know, just oh, this is my imagination. No, the words that build up the character. So say if Baggins meant, I don't know, someone who loves tea, that's all of a sudden a character trait. And then he was a burglar in the original Hobbit, that's what they called him. And then he broke down the word burglar and what it means and the German root word. It's just all this crazy shit. I was you'd be really smart to do that. The other thing, which I think makes Lord of the Rings one of the most original fantasies ever, and maybe not even nobody would really come along and duplicate it, is that the way he wrote those stories, it was as if that world already existed and he was just telling you the history of that world.
Yeah.
It's not him telling you a story for entertainment. He's telling you the history of this world as if he was the only one that saw it or witnessed it or was the Watcher or something. He was just there to witness the history of this universe and then he wrote it down. So that's really a unique take on how to do it. And then he, in interviews and stuff, somebody asked him a question. It's hey, you know, why do these certain characters in Middle Earth think why is this their job in that world? And he'd be like, huh, that's interesting. I'll have to go and find out. That'd be his response. He has to go and find out, you know, why do hobbits live in holes? Well, I have to go and find out. It's like, well, that's a crazy way to go about writing a story.
I'm sure there has to be some kind of, somebody's had to do some kind of story or something where they did Tolkien actually visiting like Middle Earth or something, like somehow like almost like a, you know, like a Western wardrobe kind of way, like some kind of poor, like, you know, and like that's how he was like writing all the things. He was just like, yeah, it was like things he just actually saw and did.
Yeah. It's just, it's so weird to think somebody wrote a story in that way, especially the root words thing. That's what really throws me, is like, you just came up.
Well, and he created like a whole genre too, basically.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, fantasy was around, but not that kind, like not the way Lord of the Rings is. But like, could you imagine if somebody was like, hey, I want to write a story about a guy named Spencer? And you'd be like, well, what does Spencer mean? Well, Spencer is Nordic for guy who masturbates a lot.
Yeah.
Well, that's going to be in the character of his whole species. They love masturbating. Mm. And what do people do who masturbate? They're sloth-like. That means they sit on the couch a lot and they don't leave their home. So that means they're very homely. And maybe they live in caves because they're dark and they like that. And it just goes on from there. Like, what the fuck? Like, how do you do that with everything? Like, you did that with all of it. And I watched a video today.
And make it to fit.
Yeah, and make it like a good story, too. But I watched a video today of him, of Tolkien. He was just kind of explaining language a little bit, and he was just writing, and I think it was Elfish. And, it, like, he just, like, looked like squiggles, like, but then there was, like, really intricate dots and everything. But he was saying, like, the words or the sounds as he was writing them, like we would do, like, doing, you know, just a normal alphabet. It was like, he created this language and then memorized it, and he could write it down. Like, that's so crazy to me. That somebody could do that. Just for what reason? Like, because you read Lord of the Rings, like, the Elfish comes up, you don't know what the fuck it means. But there's people that study it, so they probably do, but just a wild dude.
Especially back then, because it was almost kind of like, for what?
For what? Yeah, back
then. Like, what? Like, how's that making you money? Like,
he just loved words. Yeah. That's what it was. He's a professor who just really loved words.
Because, I mean, like, okay, so I didn't know he was a professor, because it was just like...
Professor Tolkien!
Well, I mean...
I opened the episode.
Yeah,
well... He's really a professor. Yeah. He was, not linguistics, I forget, it starts with a P, photo, picture, pot up, something. Some kind of word. Whatever it means, like, somebody who, like, studies languages and stuff, I think, is what he was.
I mean, well, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. I don't know how many languages he spoke, but he just loved, like, the root words, languages, and, you know, all that fun stuff. So, like, writing was just a hobby, and he didn't even think he was good at it until, finally, Lord of the Rings got picked up. So, before that, like, even, I guess, The Hobbit, I don't know how popular it was, but he didn't think he was a good writer. And I was just like, man, if you're a bad writer, what am I?
Yeah.
Maybe we'll dedicate after I do some further studying and not just ramble like an asshole, we could do like an episode dedicated on different ways of coming about stories and stuff, you know, based on Tolkien's style, like not necessarily based on his style, but just based on how he went about it. It's like, I'm sure it'd be very interesting to find out how other authors came up with like original takes on writing a story, because we just think, oh, you just write your imagination and you just drop it. No, not everybody does that. People think differently, so maybe you write a story based on the elements and how they affect the world, and you have to know the chemistry of them. I don't know. You do all kinds of fun stuff. Not us. Maybe you.
No.
You're Professor Spencer.
Well, of course, but...
Of course. Well, hey there. You are listening to the Drunken Pen Writing Podcast. I'm your host, Caleb James. With me today, Spencer, the Queensland Queefer Church. I think that's in Australia somewhere. I couldn't find a good spot on the map, so I'm using my mind. I think there's a Queensland. This may be our last episode before we hit 100, because this is just a bullshit episode. Which neither of us are drunk for, so it's not really a DBS, is it?
No, well, I mean, we don't have to... We'll kayfabe in here, you know. We could blend them in. They don't know that.
Oh, like crocodiles, man. The chocolate crocodiles, you know.
You just have to say something insensitive so that you can be like, no, I was drunk. I didn't mean to say it.
Fucking hate them jerks down at the post office.
Oh. Post office.
I don't even go to the post office. Today's episode is sponsored by DoorDash. You want your food to come at you fast? Don't get DoorDash.
Lost another one.
So, Spencer, you're going to read The Stranger here soon, huh?
Yeah, it appears that way, yes.
You excited?
I mean...
Nihilism. Yay.
Yay. That's what I need right now.
Because you just... Well, you didn't finish, but you're close to finishing something, aren't you?
I'm like 50 pages in.
The Yukio Mishima book?
Yeah.
Life for Sale. What do you think of it?
I'm enjoying it. He's like on his second client, I guess.
Yeah. Which is weird when you're going to die. A client hires you to use your life, I guess, what is it, any way they please. Yeah. Pretty much you're going to die, but then you live the first time, so try again.
Yeah.
It's a fun story, but I would just like to say, once you get done with this, don't ever think any other Yukio Mishima book you're going to read is going to be fun like that, because they're not at all. It's the only thing I've read of his that was like that. It was very out of pocket, but I liked it. I thought it was really cool.
I'd probably be farther along, but I've been trying to just read it at home. Mm. I haven't wanted to take it into work.
You don't want to see people seeing you read fine Japanese literature?
Well, no, I just, whenever you gave it to me, you just asked to make sure and try not to get too much like shit and stuff on it, you know?
Oh, because he has a hard copy to get.
That would happen a lot at work. Just, you know.
Fair enough.
And it's kind of, sometimes I'm just kind of like a hippopotamus that just whenever it's shit, it spins its tail. Just,
that's nasty.
So that's why I said I figured I'd just try to read most of it at home. So that's the only reason why it's taking me a little bit longer. I'd probably be at least halfway done with it by now.
Yeah, it's not a very long book. Like I said, I started The Return of the King, Lord of the Rings, but I just finished that Elric of Melibane, Fortress of the Pearl. Really good.
Mm-hmm.
5 out of 5 stars. Man, is that a good... And I found out, because we discussed this on air, which nobody remembers, where I said...
We don't.
I got the collection that has the books chronologically in order,
yeah,
but not the print order. He wrote that book when he was like 50. So it was like 1989, and the first one came out in like the 60s.
Oh, wow.
So remember when I said the jump from the first book to this book? I was like, that's like the writing style was like very improved and different,
yeah,
and like the tone's different. Well, that's why. It was like there's a huge gap in between those books. But the next couple, I think, are going back early. Mm. So I'm wondering how that's going to go. But I'm going to wait a little bit. I'm going to read The Lord of the Rings. And then I think I'm going to read...
Later?
Yeah, I'll read later in the evening tonight before I go to bed. Not the book Later by Stephen King. Oh, I'll bring this up in a minute. No, I'll read Later at some point by Stephen King. It's a fucking, because you read your end of the bargain, the Yukio Mishima book. Actually, I think I'm gonna jump back into Jerusalem.
Oh yeah, why?
Because I feel like I've upgraded my reading level again.
Okay.
So
you might be able to get like another like.
Once I finish this Oblivion by David Foster Wallace, I'm definitely gonna level up another time. But I noticed, just because when I was reading like that Elric of Melibane and then going back to Lord of the Rings, like my focus is way better in like just my comprehension of what I'm reading, just because jumping into, who knew, the dense fantasy with all the names and all the weird spellings, like if you actually read that enough, it changes how you read. And also, I think I've just been reading a lot of literature lately, you know, like fine literature.
Though the thing about that, though, is like the big dense things that you're diving into now are things that you enjoy and like reading.
True that, homie.
So that's going to be very different when you go to Jerusalem. And from what I've just heard from you guys talk about it, very kind of dry and boring and long-winded.
I was thinking of reading that Thomas Wolfe book, but I don't know if I hit that level yet. Because that's not just complex writing, that's also boring. Like, the combination might get me. Jerusalem, I mean, has some fun parts. Don't get me wrong. It's just, goddamn, it's long. What can you tell me? This is what I'm going to bring up. What can you tell me about Bag of Bones by Stephen King? You don't need to give me a synopsis. Just good or no good.
Middle of the road.
Ashley told me today, because he asked me if I've ever read it. And I didn't even know it was a Stephen King book because he just said the title. I think he might ask if you read it, but I didn't have an answer.
Yeah.
He said he did not finish it. He hated it.
I was going to say, I know. That's like
boring.
That, like, Tim from the comic book shop, he didn't like it either, he said.
Is it
like
a newer book, or is it from the 90s, right?
Probably, like, late 90s, early 2000s. I mean, I thought it was, okay. I mean, there was a time whenever I was, like, reading a whole bunch of Stephen King books, I was just kind of, like, going through one, putting it down, going to the next one.
So you probably were getting burnt out anyway.
A little bit, probably. They did make it into, like, a TV movie special.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's why I said like probably like middle of the road. But like, because I know a lot of people don't like Dreamcatcher, the movie or the book.
You enjoyed that?
I
didn't think the movie was that bad.
And then I enjoyed the book whenever I got around to actually reading the book. I thought, like, with the things that it, you know, obviously that don't make it into the movie and stuff like that, I thought both of those was, you know, entertaining and, you know, and stuff like that. But so, I mean, it's a matter of taste. It's another one of those, you know, a writer who ghosts and like, you know what I mean? So I could see like it's not a crazy original, but I thought like, I thought it had some good, you know, I mean, everybody knows I'm more of a King apologist than, you know, than most. So
yeah, you'll kind of not necessarily defend his shortcomings, but you will let them slide past and just kind of overlook them, which is fine. I do that. Some of my favorite, like Yuki Mishima. I mean, I recommend him to all kinds of people, but then I'm sure a lot of people are like, this is boring as fuck. Why are you making me read this? Like, well, yeah, it's fair enough. I get it.
But what brought that up? Why was he one? Did he just try to read it?
He just texted me randomly about it. I think, I can't remember if he asked if you, this was just earlier today, actually, if you read it or if he was asking if I read it.
I was just wondering, like, if he just recently tried to start it, if it would just, you know, like a while ago, he tried to start it. And
he asked me, did Spencer read Bag of Bones? And I said, I don't know. What's that? Because I should have assumed it was Stephen King. Yeah. It sounded like it, but I just never heard of that title.
What else would Ashley be asking if I read? Like, we all know
You've been upgrading a little bit. Also, I started a Robert Frost poetry collection, and I did not realize that Robert Frost has so far not for me.
No?
Which is weird because I posted some of his more famous poems on the website. You know, because you can do that when it's public domain, so old, but I really enjoyed those, but apparently those were the outliers, because in this collection, which I'm like 15, 20 pages in already, it's just like a lot of weird narratives. They don't rhyme or anything. It's like a story, but in poem form, but not like a poem you would think of, just like weird breaks, I guess. I don't know. It's hard for me to follow along, and I'm not a huge fan, because I finished that Irish poetry collection the other day. And that was all right. Like that, I like Irish poetry a good bit. But the Robert Frost just...
So is this like the... You know, you said we posted that stuff, but like, other than that, is this like the first time like reading him for you?
Yeah, I've never... It's like, you know, everyone knows The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe, but what about some of his other lesser-known poems? It's like that kind of deal. I'm sure his more famous ones will pop up in here. Oh, I think it started off with The Mending Wall, which I like that poem. But yeah, like some of these poems are just like... I don't know what I'm supposed to be feeling here, but it ain't working. So I'm just going to keep plugging through, because those are like those Barnes & Noble collections. They're real thin, and they're like $5 or something. So picked up a couple of different ones of those. I'll work my way through that anyway and just say I read it, but not enlightening me. It's not making me a better poet by any means. And
not having a good time at all.
Not really. I sit in my fancy reading chair that costs $30 from the renovation station or one of those places. I don't think that's it, but one of those places, you know, hand-me-down shit. And you know what? It is what it is, man. I like to read a couple before I get into reading my fine literature. Also, I found the Dylan Thomas poetry collection in my book bag. It was really far tucked in there. I forgot I had it.
All the way in the bottom.
And I read about half of it already previously before I just lost it in that book bag. And I really enjoyed what I read from what I remember, but I read a handful of poems just yesterday, and I was like, I must have hit the murky middle. Maybe that's why I stopped reading it. I'm not like what I'm reading now. And he's one of my favorite poets, so I don't know. Binge reading poetry, too, the way I am, it's probably not good. Like, I try to... Lately, just been like, I'll read one or two and then go read something else. Because, like, the Robert Frost, they're really long poems, so I could only read one or two at a time. But, like, when I was reading that Irish poetry collection, I was reading, like, 10 at a time. And I kind of feel like I was probably losing, you know, the feel. Like, because they're all different, but at the same time, it's like, how are you going to pull anything away when you read a whole bunch back to back to back?
You know what you should do, since you have a couple of different poem books? You should just, like, read... Like one or two out of each, like a night or whatever you read, like, you know what I mean? So that way you get like a little bit of variety. And like that way, then when you finish one, you get like four or five books out of the way. You're like,
all at once. Well, I'm going to be hitting that here soon, because I've been reading like four books at a time. So pretty soon I'm just going to finish them all. Well, they've been kind of staggered, but I've been finishing a lot of things pretty close together. I think I'm averaging, if you count like the poetry stuff, like two books a week now. Which is pretty good. I mean,
well, you also got your, looks like you're getting through your,
I haven't read this in a week.
But I mean, like, it's still, like, you're over halfway. You're, like, in the last quarter.
Almost the
it.
Middle of it, yeah, that Hemingway book. I had to take a break from that because he's, like, where I was, it's mostly about, like, war.
Yeah.
Germany. This is not the time where I want to be recollecting on fucking Nazis and anything like that, really. I think it was the First World War, actually, he's talking about, which seems very similar to... where we're headed now, and I'm like, I don't want to talk about damn.
I don't
want to read about it. I don't want to think about it. No, it just fucking sucks. So, yeah, I'm giving that a break for a little bit till some things blow over a little
more. Ooh, that's bad phrasing.
Writing wise, though, still good. Still writing every day. You hit a hot streak. You said you. Or is it just your 2 days off?
Then? Yeah, my 2 days off. Prior to the recording of this episode, I almost was able to get 1,000 words done within those 2 days and finish the chapter that I was working on, and then got me up to somewhere around the 4,400 mark, somewhere in there as like as a total, you know, so far.
But what about today?
Today, I did not do anything before coming up here.
Why?
Because I'm an asshole.
So, if it's not your day off, can't get any writing done? Is that what you're saying?
Huh? The last couple of weeks, it appears that way. But I'm hoping the rest of this week, though, I should be able to, because with us... Because,
folks, you may not know this, but we're recording a different day than we normally do.
So,
it's a secret. Don't tell them that. They don't need to know the behind-the-scenes stuff.
So, later in the week, at least the one more day should be opened up. And then, you know, also like Friday. And no, we don't have anything planned on after Fridays anyway. So, probably like by the end of the week, I'll probably have another like 300 words done.
Well, that's, I don't know how good a progress that is. I guess it's better than no progress.
Yeah.
I hit a very interesting point in my book today. I was writing a scene and realized this would be better as text messages. And then I never wrote text messages. The way I wrote it, I was like, okay, well, this will be, you know, one person on this side, one on this side. And it was only like a page and a half. But it was just really interesting because, like, thinking about the speech. Because at first I was about to write it and I was like, wait, no. That's how I would write dialogue, but that's not how it would be in a text. You don't talk the way you write in a text. How do I want to convey these people? Do I want them to see like the sound like the fucking idiots who, well, not, I'm not going to say idiots, but people to do shorthand like you is just you, the letter U, I, like one would be just the, you know, just the number one instead of the word one, things like that. And then, you know, punctuation. I left the punctuation out. So I'm just trying to find like a way to, you know, emojis too. Like I draw some little emojis because.
Yeah,
because
that's also very character building as well.
Yeah.
The different kind
of. Well, it shows a different way because we text so much now. That really shows you how people interact more than dialogue might even, like, you know, in modern cases. So seeing this couple text each other, that gives you a different feel for the relationship. So I was playing with that. And I've seen in books. None that I've actually bought or read, but I've seen scenes and books just flipping through in the bookstore that had like text and it was like actual, almost like a picture of text or something. Like it wasn't just formatted to be like the font. It was actual like a picture. I don't think I would want that in my book necessarily. I would like to do something wonky with the font if they could, but I don't know. I mean, I'm not really worried about that. I just think, it's really interesting because I've never written text into a story. I'd be really interested to see what, like, our, you know, some of our listeners that are writers, like, if they do that. Because I write modern fiction, but I've never really steered into the technological aspect for the most part. Most of my stories, like, I don't even really have the cell phones, you know, prominent in them or anything, which was really confusing for me when I first went into this. I think we even had a discussion. Should I make this like in the 90s or something? Because adding the cell phone fucks up so many scenes. I mean, besides the fact that the information, like, you know, all the tropes of, you know, getting lost or not being able to contact somebody or getting a hold of something, like, all that's like. Any episode of Seinfeld is horse hockey. So I was thinking about that when we discussed that. And then I was just the interaction. I don't know if I was afraid or if I just didn't think I'd do a good job of just actually doing the interaction. And then how much do you want to, you know, dive into it? Like I said, I'm writing text out. Mm. Do you want to do that, or do you just want to imply that they're, you know, oh, he texted her, but do you want to show it or not? That's the angle there. And then because I think I already fucked up at the early, because these, my character is in the early 20s. So I already fucked up because I had, like, in one of the first scenes, like, the girl just, like, called him or something and said, hey, I'm coming over. And then I was thinking, she wouldn't call him. No, the fuck she wouldn't. No, nobody calls anybody anymore. Old heads do. These young folks ain't calling nobody. So I might have to retcon that. But have you thought about doing that in your work at all? Just, like, you know, is your story you're writing now current? Is it a modern story?
No, it's actually... it's like near future kind of
thing. So the technology might even be more advanced. So
yes, but in a way, like, I haven't had to do too much with it yet, but like in my mind, I picture it as one of those, like, it's advanced, but in an advance of, like, if you look at, like, from like the 90s to like now, like there's been crazy leaps in technology, yeah. But things are also kind of like very much the same. And, like, a lot of ways, like, you know, like, there's not, you know, like, flying cars, yeah. But, like, you know, structures are kind of a little bit different because, like, you know what I mean?
The vehicles we do have would be, like, cooler.
Yeah, and just, like, you know what I mean? And then, obviously, because, like, the thing that I'm writing about, obviously, like, this huge company, they have, you know, better technology where, you know, the other people got, like, you know, like, the write-off, you know what
knock
I mean?
Off shit,
and,
yeah.
And stuff like that, so...
Are you implementing, like, communication device, like cell phones, or...
Not yet, but, like, I'm getting to the point to where the shit's about to hit the fan, and then sort of, and things are gonna go crazy, so, like, I don't know if I were, that would probably be the way. I haven't decided if I was gonna have my character, like, interact or how we would interact with other people, you know what I mean, yet.
I think it'd probably be beneficial for both of us if we wrote a couple flash fiction stories that were cell phone heavy.
Oh, if just a text message in general.
Text, well,
yeah, just like a text message, like a flash fiction.
Well,
of
all the scenes, like, have an actual story set, you know. The story itself, just for that writing exercise, really doesn't matter too much. Just say it's a couple people going out at night on town. Pandemic, no pandemic, man. Whatever. But have that cell phone prominent the whole time. So what are they doing in the back of the Uber? Cell phone, probably playing on their phone, not talking to each other, really. Obviously, the texting each other, looking up random shit.
What would be interesting is to do, like, that, but, like, have it, because, like, I think this is, like, a, you know, a thing girls do, you know, how they have the group text. Like, you know, yeah. Say they'd be in the Uber, they're not talking, they're all texting each other in a group text because they don't want to talk where, you know, anybody else is there or you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. So it almost kind of be like you would have the story, but you get, like, these characters not in a monologue because it'd be them talking, but that's how you get what they're feeling and thinking is through the, you know, the group text message.
And then you could do that stupid thing where girls use, like, Snapchat to send video clips to each other of them talking about whatever topic they're talking about. But they use, like, a funny voice filter or something stupid for no reason. And then it's just, like, that's how they communicate, which is really bizarre. Like, I think it's very strange. Like, sending video clips to each other, and that's how you're telling these stories. Seems very, impersonal in a way. I don't know. But just things like that adding to the story. And then even you can look into, like, the kids or, like, where it's hard to do it is to tell this story where cell phones and things like that are so prominent, like the modern technology, but not make that the theme. Like, oh, people are so, like, it's not a commentary on people being addicted to smartphones and internet and stuff. It's not a commentary on anything like that. It's just, you know, the story takes place in this setting. So it would be like in the 30s, somebody on the train read a newspaper. Well, now they're just reading an article on their phone. You have to be very subtle with it.
You know what would be an easier or maybe an interesting take on that? Instead of being text on, you know, on the phone, what about if it's like a message board on like a Warcraft kind of game?
Yeah.
So you're telling this
story. Or like a Twitch stream or something.
Yeah, so you got this... the story that they're also doing, but you also got the people playing this story, their, like, commentary, and that's like, you know, we always talk about on the Dead Robots Society writing those like lit RPGs.
Yeah,
and like that what? Just makes no sense to me at all. Sounds
very hard.
Like that, I don't. That's something I wouldn't want to. I don't even think I would want to read that.
No, I don't know. I would have to see how it is. I don't see. I'm just very hesitant to jump into that because I know a lot of indie authors and stuff personally who they just make sure all their stories are set before cell phones. That's the easiest way to get around it. But I do want to tell modern story. Like the story I'm telling now, I want to tell the story has nothing to do with cell phones and technology, but it's just the time they're living in. It's going to be prominent. Yeah, just I don't fucking. It's weird because like we think like okay, like The Hike by Drew McGarry. That was like a modern book, but do you really remember cell phones too much in that or anything like that?
No.
He did have him, but it wasn't really like prominent in any way.
Well, because that's, you know, 10 or 15 pages in, he starts going
into weird world. Yeah,
so like the phone wouldn't have, and then, you know, once things happen to you there, you know what I mean? He probably didn't even have it.
How does like Stephen King handle that kind of stuff? Like in his modern stories, or does he not write stories set in modern times?
No, they're pretty modern. He'll probably either would have just, you know, there's always maybe like interference or just, you know, dead or just maybe they're not working.
What I always thought was really scary, and I take this from real life, like people getting attacked by bears and stuff and they're calling for help.
Yeah.
Is not the interference, not the phone's dead, not any of that. The phone's working. They get in contact with somebody, but the murderer gets them anyway while they're on the line. Like, yeah. I always thought that was more scary because it's almost like it gives you a false sense of safety. It's like, oh my God, I got to hold a 911. I'll be okay now, but then you still get it. Because I use like the bear attack because there's a couple instances where people were calling for help because a bear's chasing them or something crazy, and it gets them. It's a fucking bear.
Yeah.
And then it's just like, oh, damn, like we got him on recording getting mauled. Like, that's horrifying.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, you got a serial killer coming for you, hiding in the closet, and you're texting for help and stuff, and it's like, don't worry, we got you, we're coming. But then, you know, it's too late.
You know, a movie that did a real good thing like that, I'm going to spoil the shit out of it because it's pretty old. Yeah, Ryan Reynolds movie, and he's in the army somewhere, and he got kidnapped, and...
Oh, the one where he's buried alive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was really good, and he's talking to him, and, like, they're like, oh, we think we found it. And, like, they wasn't don't. Right. Yeah. They don't find him, and he fucking dies.
Horrifying, yeah. I never watched that movie, but I know the premise, and I've seen scenes from it. I'm like, this would be so fucked up. Like, that's such a horrifying thing, because it's like, they know you need help.
Yeah,
like the people that you want to help you know you need help, but
you're
they
talking
can't.
To them. Like, yeah,
they're looking for you. You just have to hold on. But how long can you hold on? Like that'd be fun to write a story like that, I think. But yeah, like the whole cell phones, I don't know.
The next easiest way is to write older characters.
They don't use cell phones
that don't
as much.
Like using them godfangled things,
or don't use them the right, you know, the right way.
Yeah,
because you don't call people; you text them for no reason, even if it's. You know, something that could easily be solved over a call. You text them a bunch of nonsense and fight back and forth over it.
You know what I'm surprised nobody's ever done? Is just create, like, an alternate history, like, unit, like, story. And, like, have other stories placed in it where just, like, cell phone advancement is very low. Like, you know what I mean?
I always thought it'd be cool to tell a story where Tesla did get his free energy idea working. Like, the government didn't shut him down because... His idea was to take energy from the sky because there's energy all around us. Like there's electricity all around us. He harnessed that electricity and then that was what powers the world. But the problem is if he did that, you couldn't have cell phones because like the interference, like it would fuck up. I don't even think you have satellites. Like there would be too much interference, like too much electricity in there, all kinds of shit. It's been a long time since I read that, but like, could you imagine that? Because we wouldn't even known, like cell phones wouldn't have been an idea. Because it would have been like, oh, we can't invent that because of, you know, how our world works. Yeah. Couldn't be a cell phone. Like, there's no radio. There's no Wi-Fi. I don't know if radio would still even work. I'm not sure. But I think that would be really fun to do a world like that where crazy technology, but then you can't have all the other stuff.
Which would be interesting because you have all this extra electricity and power. You
can't use it.
But like the most of the stuff that you'd want to use it for, you wouldn't have.
Or you'd have to come up with new technology. Like what would a cell phone be like then if it was, you know, it couldn't run off of fucking towers. Like it'd be weird. I don't know, man. But that's our big technology episode.
Oh, is this what this episode was about?
Not at all. I didn't have a plan for this episode. We're just rambling. But I do want to end it because I'm hungry. So
Caleb needs his meats.
This has been the Drunken Pen Writing Podcast. You can follow us on drunkenpenwriting.com. You can go to Twitter at Drunken Pen Writing. You can go to Instagram and Facebook at Drunken Pen Writing. And then you can enjoy all our work. And then you can like and subscribe on YouTube if you really want to. And then you can go to Spencer's OnlyFans at the Queensland Queefer Church.
Whew.
I never ever did the outro that fast.
No.
I don't even know on playback if that'll be, if you can even hear that. But I don't care. Next episode might be our 100th episode. So stick around. We do got to come up with new music. But that can wait till next time. See you later.